Connecting low-power devices to the cloud is something critical to lots of businesses these days. But it's not always simple because you have different protocols, different technologies, different servers. Tartabit is a company offering an interesting solution to streamline connecting all these low-power devices to Azure. And Jim Burt is here to tell us everything you need to know about this solution. That's today on the IoT Show. Hi, everyone. This is the IoT Show. I'm Olivier, your host. And today we'll be talking about connecting low power devices to Azure. And for that, we have Jim with us. Jim, how are you?
Hey, Olivier. Thanks for having me. I'm doing pretty good.
All right. So where are you calling us from?
Calling from Ottawa, Canada.
Okay. How's the weather up there these days?
It's a little brisk today for June.
A little brisk. Yeah, I think we are feeling the same thing here in the Seattle area. It's kind of fresh. I wish the actual spring or summer is coming. Anywho, so who is Jim and what are you doing in life, sir?
So I'm CTO at a company called Tartabit. We formed 2 years ago to specifically address the problem of connecting low power wide area assets into the Azure ecosystem. Now, you know, what is low power wide area? Well, if you understand the space, let's say if you have a Cat 1, Cat 3, anything cellular that might be a connected camera or a high-end kiosk, there are great SDKs available for Microsoft to get you connected into the Azure ecosystem. The problem is, what happens when you're trying to do a solution with LTE Cat-M, narrowband IoT, satellite, LoRa, you're using a device that's on a half megamonth data plan, and you're trying to get a 5-year battery life? The reality is that the existing SDKs and tools are just not conducive for these types of solutions. So what we've done is we've implemented a wide variety of the most popular industry standard communication tools for these low power devices and integrated them into a single platform to really accelerate customers integrating into the Azure ecosystem.
That's great, because at the end of the day, when we're talking about IoT and especially the things in IoT, a lot of them are things that are run on batteries, things that are just tiny sensors. And you were saying that, you know, the SDKs that we have for connecting to Azure devices to Azure, there are definitely software SDKs that run on OSs, right? Whether they're real-time OSs or bigger ones. So these tinier sensors might not even have an OS on them. They're just communicating through these different types of networks. From your experience, and because you're in the industry, what's the percentage of these things, you know, as part of the IoT, would be considered low power? Is it like a tiny percentage, or is it the vast majority of these devices?
So if I play the game in that you have to talk kind of the balance between the business side and the actual technology, the low power devices more than likely make up a majority of the number of units that are out in the field. But mm-hmm. These are the units that are extremely cheap across the stack. They send data once per day, once per hour. The device may only be $20 or $30. So from a revenue perspective, there's far more money in the high-end device space. Do you want to buy a $1,500 connected camera, or do you want to buy a $25 asset tracking sensor? So depending on how you look at it, volume-wise, the low-power devices is a huge part of the industry. Value to the industry, the higher consumption devices still are a bigger portion of the market from a revenue perspective.
That makes sense. And so if I bring up the slide, so these various devices connect using different technologies. So tell me a bit about, before you show me, how are you guys reconciling the formats of data, because like every single of these protocols have their own way of, you know, formatting the data from the sensor all the way up to, you know, behind, say, a gateway or something. So how are you guys reconciling all of that to make sense of the data for Azure?
So our approach is that we have our southbound and our northbound connections. So southbound might be a connector for lightweight M2M, very popular in the cellular connected space, or connectivity to one of the major LNS providers in the LoRa space. Mm-hmm. Northbound would be connections into Azure IoT Hub or IoT Central or Digital Twins or Azure Data Explorer. And in the middle is the essence of our technology, which is a low-code scripting layer where you can import templates and rapidly create applications to map the data model coming out of the device into a data model that the northbound application understands.
Okay. Well, I think you need to show us a little. You came with some demos, okay, and we want to talk about some of these protocols with actual examples.
Yeah, let's see it. Okay, so here we are at the IoT Bridge. So as always, we start by signing in. Mm-hmm. And what we're going to do is we're going to start by looking at something using lightweight M2M. So lightweight M2M is a protocol that is highly constrained. It runs over CoAP and UDP. It uses DTLS for the security. You can see we are a neutral platform, so we have devices from many different manufacturers connected. So these are all basically represent connected devices. Some are physical, some are virtual. We can delve into these devices and you can see the data model. So if you come from the IoT Hub space, you may be aware of DTDL modeling and being able to create a representation of your device. Lightweight M2M has its own modeling framework that's designed to help optimize the communications, but you can get an indication for the type of data that might come off of one of these devices. So I can see information about the manufacturer. In this case, I'm looking at a device from Nordic Semiconductor. It has numerous sensors available on it that have that can provide all sorts of information. Okay, gas resistance, maybe something more relatable to everybody, temperature sensor. So this information, it all comes through the standard model. And now the question is how do we get this data into something more usable? And for that, we'll look at the low-code piece that stitches our solutions together. So here we have what we call our triggers, that low-code element that goes and puts the different pieces together. So let's start here by looking at how we can send data to IoT Central. Mm-hmm. So here I have a trigger, process lightweight M2M data. So what is this? Let's kind of take a second and look at the anatomy of what we're doing here. So I'm looking at an event, and it could be a event coming from the north. So maybe somebody changed to Azure Digital Twin. Maybe I'm receiving something from a IoT hub, or it could be a data coming from a device. So in this case, I could catch when the device registers to my server. I could catch when data arrives. In this case, I'm looking for data. And if I kind of browse the events coming in, we can see samples of what's coming off this device. So here is data from the gas resistance sensor. Now, in this case, we're seeing it from a different device than we were looking at before. So we're seeing simulated data, but you can see the format that it comes in and all these numbers. You say, boy, what is all that? This is all part of the naming schema that is part of lightweight M2M. So at the end of the day, what am I trying to do though? I am taking this data model that comes from the device, and I'm using our low code layer to match this application to a specific DTDL model so that I can send the data to IoT Central. And then at the end, I call my magic functions, take some of this data and update it, do a twin update, and then send the rest as telemetry. So here we are in my IoT Central account, and we're, you notice we're looking at the same device, the Nordic Semi Thingy 91, and I can see now my data coming in. And if you remember the data format we were using before, you're now looking at it in a completely different format, because this is what matches the DTDL model that I happen to be using right now. And so we can see the data coming in. We can go and view the sensor data and the location in on the map. So we have everything coming in with the from this particular device. And whether it's the Nordic device, whether it's a different device, it all comes through in the exact same way.
So you just showed us, you know, ingesting LWN2M, and you're saying you're supporting other protocols. Do you want to show us an example real quick with LoRa One? Actually, I'm curious to see how that looks like as well, because it's not the same data format. I'm curious to see how that conversion of the data looks for LoRa.
Very good question. Okay, so let me go back and close out of here, and we'll switch over to look at a LoRa use case. Okay. So here now we can see that I have a number of different devices connected. The unique attribute here is actually these devices are connected on a wide variety of networks. So I have a bunch of devices connected on Helium. I have devices connected on Senate. I have devices connected on Things Network. I have devices connected on Laureate. We support a wide variety of LNS connections natively. And part of our magic is providing that normalized decoding and management of that data. So if we look at any one of these particular devices, we can see that I'm identifying it by its device EUI, the way you identify a LoRa device. Mm-hmm. And I then simply pick what its device type is from a library of over 400 different devices that we have available. In this case, it's a Brown object locator. And if I go and I look at the events that are coming off this device, we can see that I get a bunch of information from the LoRa server. In this case, it's a Helium gateway. But the most important thing is that I'm getting my data in already decoded so that I can simply take this now and again map it into my northbound application. So in this case, let's maybe look at sending the data into a Azure Data Explorer or a Custo mm-hmm. database. So what am I doing? Now, exactly the same model as before. Instead of looking at lightweight M2M data, I'm looking for LoRaWAN uplink messages. What am I going to do? Well, if I have decoded data, I'm going to look, and if I know if I have, it, let's say, an industrial tracker or an object locator, I can go and build up my record and send this data on to our Azure Custo database. And so here we can see an example of an application where I'm getting my data in. I can do all sorts of diagnostics on what might be available. If we go look at, let's say, one of those object locators, mm-hmm. it hasn't exactly moved in it's located at my home. But you know, we see the telemetry coming from this device. We can see all the information. And again, you know, there was no customization required, no extra Azure functions. Everything is direct from our platform into the database.
I like it. I like it a lot. And you just demonstrated something super interesting just in the context of LoRa, is the fact that you don't really, you're supporting so many different platforms that are used today by our customers. So the point I want to make here is that brownfield scenarios where you need to IoTify existing infrastructure and connect them to the cloud to extend, you know, functionality, extract insights, and so on. These are already existing, right? People are using LoRaWAN today within the LNS, and then they're doing the decoding, and then they're using their own customer application. And you can just plug at that level. You don't require a customer to go and change, you know, the way they are dealing with devices or the existing infrastructure, correct?
Correct. We've seen we're moving away from the vertical IoT applications, and IoT is now everywhere. Every aspect of your enterprise application and your let's say the visibility of this IoT information needs to be pervasive. hey, we need to get some of the data into Microsoft Dynamics for real-time ticket creation. Hey, finance needs mileage from the vehicles broken down by state so that they can pay their the road taxes. The operations group wants to know what devices have low batteries so that they can schedule maintenance crews to go fix it. Each of these is a completely different system selected by a completely different BU, but it all needs access to that same fundamental IoT data. And so this is where we've really excelled at helping customers get the data where they need to get it in a highly reliable, robust way, and that really kind of cut out a lot of the middleware that was typically required for these solutions. Yeah.
And I like the pivot you're proposing, which is we've been talking a lot about connecting assets to the cloud using a cloud gateway, which in our case is called Azure IoT Hub and powers IoT Central. And instead of like telling people and customers, hey, you absolutely have to go to that one cloud gateway for devices, well, some devices will definitely be able to go directly to that cloud gateway with using our SDKs. But as a matter of fact, if you have an LNS, a LoRaWAN infrastructure or LWM in infrastructure, you already have the device management and connectivity taken care of. You don't need to have yet a new, cloud device gateway. What you need is to pivot around the data itself and translating the data from one format to the one that is understood by the cloud services, right?
Correct. And, I would still say more than half of our northbound connections are to IoT Hub. Customers do like the uniformity because even if they have multiple types of assets, maybe it's a utility and the substations all report in with high-end industrial PCs and logic controllers, and those all report up through IoT Hub. They want their low-powered assets that are tracking the service trucks to report through common infrastructure as well. So we're not trying to bypass things like IoT Hub in all cases, but we're trying to give people that path to get the data where it needs to go, because sometimes it's as easy as saying, well, yes, the bulk of my data is going to IoT Hub, but for some security analysis, we also want to tap a data going into log analytics, or we need data getting dumped onto a separate event hub. So we multiplex as needed.
Nice. I love it. So Jim, this was a great demo, great insights into the solution. How does it present itself for our customers? I think it's on the marketplace, right?
Yeah. So, the great thing is we make it super easy to get started. It's available on the marketplace. Free trials available. You can get started with our SaaS in a few minutes. All resolves through your existing Azure account. If you're a customer who may need more security, more control, we do offer private instances that can be launched in your own Azure tenant so that you have complete control. We have no access, compatible with private networks, utility networks, and the like. So we have a lot of different ways to do business, and we're very excited with our relationship with Microsoft.
Love it. So I just brought up the link down here, and you were showing it at the same time as well, the marketplace entry. So people can go and try it for free on their Azure subscription. So that's ak.ms/it/tartabit/IoT Bridge. That's the name of that module on the marketplace. Jim, thanks a lot for your time today. Hope to see you soon on the IoT show again, right?
Thank you, Olivier. I hope to be back again.
You will, for sure. Well, thanks everyone for tuning in, and see you on the IoT show. Bye.